Hello all. In this tutorial, we'll learn about basic digital circuits on FPGA board using FPGA design tools. And till now, we have studied how to write a Verilog code and how to simulate that code and test the functionality of the design. So before going on to actually designing the circuit in Verilog and using the tools, I would like to tell you something about FPGA manufacturers that are there currently in the industry. So there are almost 5 major manufacturers in FPGA currently. So those are Xilinx, Altera, and Lattice. These are the 3 major contributors of FPGA market currently. So Xilinx share almost 49% of the market, FPGA market. Altera shares almost 40% of the market. Lattice has 6% of the market, and there are 2 other FPGA manufacturers, Microsemi and QuickLogic. They share very small amount, like 4% and 1% of market share. So most of the FPGAs are produced by Xilinx and Altera that are currently used in the industry. And I'll just quickly list down few of the families that each of these manufacturers produce. So in Xilinx, we have Spartan series. We have currently we have 7 series FPGAs, and the most recent one is the Ultra Scale FPGAs that has come up. So these are 7 series FPGAs are 28 nanometer technology, and some of the ultra scale FPGAs are of 18 nanometer technology. So these are the most recent devices that have been that is there in the market currently. And in Altera we have something called Cyclone family and Artix family and Stratix family. So these are 28 nanometer technologies, and Altera has been recently acquired by Intel. So this is Altera devices, and in Lattice we have something called ECP2, ECP3, I series kind of devices. And these are the basic application devices that we find in industry. So correspondingly, each manufacturers have their own design tools, wherein we use the tools to port the design onto the board, onto the devices that they provide. So Xilinx has ISC design tool, and recently they have come up with Vivado for the 7 series FPGAs, and Altera had Quartus 2, and recently they have upgraded it to Quartus Prime, and Lattice they have Diamond as a tool. So these are the tool names. They basically do the Verilog design, help us to implement the Verilog design on the board. So we'll study in this tutorial how to use the Vivado tool and one of the 7 series FPGAs, specifically Artix 7 family, which is used in a development board called Nexus 4. So we will use Vivado design tool to on the development board Nexus 4 to create some digital disk circuit. So we
does not come on this ultra scale,
na? Yes, it is. It comes. Zing series also come in ultra scale. So this is a basic Nexus 4 board, how it looks like. So I have got the board, so you may want to look at it. So this is a basic FPGA board, Nexus 4 board. The main component of this board is the FPGA, Artix 7 FPGA. It is an Artix 700T device. We'll come to know about it more in later slides. So I'll give what are the basic interfaces and the peripherals that are there in this device. So main component of this board is the Artix 7 FPGA, since it's an FPGA development board, and we power on this board using two interfaces. First is the adapter that is there here, and there's a USB micro USB power. So these are the two methods that we can use to power on the board. So I'll be using the USB method to power on the board. I'll show it in later how it does. So we can select onto which power source we have to choose using this jumper. So we now know how to power on the board. Now we have to program the FPGA in order to make it work like a circuit that we want to design. So there are different modes using which we can program the FPGA. So there are basically four kinds of mode. First is a USB. Through USB JTAG we can program the FPGA. Second is through micro SD card. So we have a micro SD card slot here in this FPGA. So through the programming file present in the micro SD card, we can program the FPGA. And there is an onboard SPI flash on this board through which we can program the FPGA, and that is a non-volatile flash memory. So we can even if the power is off, we can in the next power on, we can load the whatever programming file was stored in the flash, we can load that again without really have to program manually. So that kind of programming approach is used when the board goes in an application. And we also have USB HID board which also can be used to program the FPGA, and this USB port can be used to interface with any USB mouse or keyboard that we use in computers. So this is a basic programming. So we now know how to power the FPGA, how to program the FPGA with a programming file. Now we'll see what are the memories that we have in this board. So this board is called Nexus 4 DDR because it has a DDR SD RAM, and it is 128 megabyte DDR RAM. It also has a serial flash apart from the SPI flash that I talked about, 16 MB. It has a Ethernet RJ45 connector which can be used as a Ethernet interface, which allows 10 to 100 Mbps Ethernet connection. We have a VGA port. There is an XADC pins that are there in this FPGA. So this FPGA supports analog inputs. So for that we have these P mods on board, and through these P mods we can directly access that analog inputs that are there in the FPGA, on this particular FPGA. Also in this board we have some other peripherals like accelerators, mono audio output, switches. These are the basic IOs, consists of the LEDs, switch buttons, and this 7-segment display. So we'll come to that in the next slide. So now I have shown the basic Nexus 4 DDR components and its interfaces, how we power it on and how we program the FPGA. So we'll now see what are the basic IOs of this Nexus 4. So in this slide you can see, as I have told, we have buttons, switches, LEDs, 7-segment display, and there are reset buttons. So if you see, there is a CPU reset and there is a program reset button. So if you press this reset button, whatever you have programmed into the FPGA, it gets reset. You have to program it again, or it will load from the non-volatile memory, whatever it is, what was there in that. Okay, so we have 5 push buttons, as you can see here, and they give high output only when they are pressed. They are connected as shown in this figure. So these are the push buttons, and these are the pins in the FPGA where it is connected. We have slide switch, 16 slide switches. So it depends upon what position it is. So according to the position, it will be 0 or 1. Correspondingly, the FPGA input will be 0 or 1. Also, we have 16 LEDs corresponding to these each switches here. So same way, whenever there is a high logic, the LEDs glow up. So I will like to explain a little bit on the 7-segment display here. So how the 7-segment display, how we can use 7-segment display. So let me draw basic 7-segment display. So this is a basic one digit of the 7-segment display, and each digit is composed of 7 LEDs. So I'll name them A, B, C. So each LEDs have an anode and a cathode connection. So you can consider it like this. So how these are connected is so these are, suppose there are two digits. So each anode of each anode of this digit are connected together. So these are all A, B, C, D, E, F, G are all LEDs. So the anode connections are all shorted, and the cathode connection are taken out from each of these, and they are shorted. Hope it is clear for you. So all the anode connection of a particular digit is shorted, and all the individual cathode like CA, C1A, C2A, or like if this is first digit and this is the second digit, all these are all these are shorted. Hope it is clear.
Each line has one diode. Each time the anode they are sorted.
Yeah. So what happens is from the FPGA, if we drive low to both of these, that particular segment gets eliminated. So that is how we control the 7-segment display. So this is about the basic IOs. So in this tutorial, I will try to use some of the basic IOs to show you how a very basic circuit is being generated, programmed, and used in the board. So let's move on to next. So I would like to describe a few things about Arctic 7 FPGAs. So the FPGA that is used in this particular board is XE7A100T. 7 specifies the series and 100T specifies the number of logic cells that are used. So Xilinx have their 7 series FPGAs, and particularly Arctic 7, which is a low cost and low power volume family. This is used for low cost and low power applications, and they also have Vertex 7 and Kintex 7 family. This depends on, so the family different families have different applications, and their performance and power consumption differ. So now I'll talk about the Arctic 7 series that we are using in this particular board. So we have 100k logic cells, and we have around 15k logic slices. Each slice have 4-6 input LUTs and 8 flip-flops. So we'll see how this particularly we can see how this composition or this architecture we can see in the tool. So these are the basic Arctic 7 features which you can find in the data sheet of the device also. So I have put the references in the last slide, so you can check it out. So let's move on to Vivado IDE solution. So Vivado was introduced by Xilinx for 7 series FPGAs. They have an interactive design. It is an interactive design tool which is used for many things like timing analysis, resource utilization, IO assignment, etc. It is also used for RTL development and analysis. There is a simulator, built-in simulator XSim, which is used in Vivado. So also this in Vivado they support TCL scripting, so we can directly use command line to launch some of the IDE solutions, like some of the tools, or to synthesize or implement the design. So we will see how we can do that later. Also, we in Vivado they provide IP catalog, which can be used to integrate ready-made IPs that are available in the industry in your current design. So everything is included in one particular package. So that's why it's a Vivado IDE solution.
We can use either that XSIM or Model SIM.
Yes, we can use Model SIM also. So before we actually go into the tool and I give you a detail, I would like to recall what we had studied about the FPGA design flow. So we have first the design entry. Here in this tutorial, we'll be using design entry based on Verilog and IP catalog. Then the design is synthesized. Before the synthesis, we do a functional verification or behavioral verification of the circuit that we have written in Verilog. That is called behavioral simulation using XSIM tool. And then we implement the design where we do translate, map and place and route of the design. Once the implemented design is ready, we convert it into a binary form which is called bitstream, and then we program it onto the board. So this is the basic flow. And we also do functional simulation, static timing analysis and timing simulation once the implementation is done to check whether the performance meets our specification. This is the basic FPGA design flow which is followed in Xilinx tools mostly and in mostly other tools also. So we'll now see how we go about designing using a Vivado IDE tool. So so first what you should be doing is you should be downloading the web edition Vivado that is available online in Xilinx's website, and you have to first create an account so that you get a web edition license. So you download the software, install the license, and you have a working Vivado tool for your testing purpose. Some of the features are only available through licensed version, like not free, but most of it is free in the web edition for our understanding purposes. So okay, so I'll just open it. Okay, before this I would like to explain some more thing. So I will be showing a project based on this design. So we'll design a 3:8 decoder which has 3 inputs and 8 outputs, and you can see the truth table. This is what the circuit behaves as. So if there is a 0, if x is 0, output will get y0 as 1. So this is correspondingly, so you know the 3:8 decoder functionality. So this is a starting opening page of the Vivado tool. We create a new project first. You specify the project location where you want to make the project. So I'll do it here. So we are making an RTL project, we will select RTL project. We add the sources that we need to add. So I have already written a Verilog code for this, so I'll add directly from here. So I'll add this source. If you have existing IPs that you want to reuse, you can add it over here. I am just using only the decoder code, so I am not adding anything here. You can add constraint files also here. So in the Nexus 4DDR site, Digilens site, they have provided the X constraints file. I'll tell you in detail what a constraint file is. Basically it gives a physical location and the timing constraint of the device. So it is already provided by the board vendor. So I have added this. So here we have a part selection thing. So we have parts and boards. So if we have our own custom board, we'll have to specify the FPGA device family that we are using. So if we have a board like us, what we have, so they have separately listed out the board, so we don't have to specify each and everything separately. So I select the Nexus 4 DDR board here. So we are good to go. We are now creating a new project. This is the IDE page. When you open a project, we have Flow Navigator, which has all these things. So I'll go through it one by one. So we have our code that I've written here, which we have added. So I'll just open it in the editor. So this is the editor, and this is the code that I've written in Verilog. So let's see first what are the project settings that are there. So we have mentioned the which device we are using through the board setting. So we are using Nexus 4 DDR and this particular device 100T device, and we are using a target language Verilog, which we can change. So we can have VHDL or Verilog here. These are all default settings that will keep it to the default. Then we go to the simulation settings, which is a target simulator that we are using, Vivado simulator. And the simulator supports, by default it supports mixed language simulation, which means that we can simulate a design which has Verilog as well as VHDL files. And these are all the basic settings which we'll keep for now as default settings. This is the elaboration, which tells what kind of elaboration does a tool do. These are the synthesis settings. So we have different kind of settings that are possible. There are more options. So for now we'll keep all this as default, whatever it is there. And again, similarly, we have implementation settings. Which kind of bitstream do we need at the output? And the IP core settings. So we have seen the project settings now. Similar what we saw in the new project phase, like the same thing, we can add sources here. If later on in the design we find that we need to add a design, add a source, we can add a source here. Language templates. So language template is a very good thing that I feel that the Xilinx people have added. So we have different languages support with Vivado, and they provide a basic template for everything that they have. So they have some device specific instantiation templates, and they have some language specific constructs. So we studied in, we have some Verilog constructs and all. So they have given, so let me start with some of the things that you already know, like case and conditional assignment. So they have given the basic syntax and construct here, so that you can look it up whenever there is some error that you are facing. Similarly, there are many things, like you can check coding examples, like all the basic digital circuits and their examples, example codes. So this is a basic adder design. These are basically language constructs, and you can look it up whenever you are free. You can like explore it more. They have macro, they are device specific instantiation templates also. So next we'll see IP catalog. IP catalog is basically whatever is available from the Xilinx repositories, Xilinx. So these are all IP cores that Xilinx provide for free with Vivado, that we can instantiate in our project or in our design. So we will be using one of it. If time permits, I'll try to explain or try to show a design using an embedded processor, something called Microblaze. So we can directly instantiate this processor as a black box in our device. So that is IP catalog.
What exactly is the IP catalog?
It's a catalog of IPs, intellectual properties. So So if we have a, suppose we have a decoder and we have designed it to for different application, like we have H.264 video encoders and decoders, so they can be used across application for different purposes. So our design can be used for different applications, we package it as an IP and people sell it, so that a new person don't have to write it again. So that's basically what IP catalog contains, such kind of IPs. So here it is Xilinx specific because I am using Vivado, and there are only IPs which Xilinx provides for free. So we have already seen simulation settings here. Okay, so let me add a decoder simulation file here so that we can see whether our design is working properly. So I'll add a simulation source. So you can see it has come here. TB. So this is the basic test bench. Okay, so let's run this and see. Here you can see that inside the test bench module we have all the design, basic design, and we are verifying it using some of the inputs. So here I'm increasing k every call, so I'm just giving 0, 1, 2, like that, like I'm just incrementing the input. If you see, the simulator gives us exact output what the design has to give. So we have provided 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 up until 7 as the input, and the simulator tells us that the design that we have written using Verilog gives us this particular output. So the default numeric value that you or the diadics that you see is hexadecimal. I can convert it into binary or decimal, and you can check. I think binary would be easier for you to understand. So these are different for different values according to the truth table that we had, we have the output values. So this is a basic simulation, how we do the simulation in Vivado. Okay. So let's now synthesize the design. You can see that we have run the simulation, synthesis is running, and you can see the message log also. So now once the synthesis is done, we'll run the implementation. It depends upon the machine that it is, the tool is running, so it takes time. No, it is integrated inside the Vivado tool. So the basic Vivado simulator is XSim. So we'll generate a bitstream. So you can see the project summary here actually. We have completed synthesis without any errors. And the implementation is run, like the bitstream generation is still running, and we have got two warnings. If we have had a synchronous design with clock, we would have got timing information also. So currently, like I'm not given anything. So we have successfully generated a bitstream. So before we program the FPGA, we have not added a constraint file here. So there is no way that the particular bitstream will have the information that which input or which output is connected to which port on the FPGA. So that's why we'll have to add a okay, I have already added. So in the constraint file, I'll show you what the constraint file has. The constraint file has all the pins, input and output pins of the FPGA. And I have connected the inputs X 3-bit inputs to the switches on this board, to these switches on this board. And the outputs, the Y outputs, 8-bit outputs are connected to the these particular LEDs. So we can see with the change in this inputs, we can see LEDs, different LEDs glowing. Okay, so I'll connect this and we can see quickly. So this is the power LED which shows us the FPGA is on. Now we will open the hardware manager. We'll open the target. Since we have connected this, we'll program it through JTAG interface. And we'll program. So you can see that the FPGA is programmed. There is a done LED which shows that the FPGA is programmed, and if you reset this button, the program file is erased completely. So we'll have to program it again. So that is what this switch does. So we'll program the device again. As you can see, 00, the switch condition is 000 input of the decoder, and we have an LED which glows. So that is the corresponding Y output. So I'll just quickly show the basic 3:8 decoder working using this board. So we have one first LED glowing, we have third LED glowing, four, 5, 6, and 7. So this is a 3:8 decoder that is working on board. Okay, so hope you have understood how to work with a board and how to port a digital circuit onto the onto a Xilinx RTX 7 board using Vivado design. So for all other boards and for all other tools, it is very similar. It's just that the naming differs and some of the conventions differ. Other than that, the basic flow remains same. So I would like to show you how this particular design that we have ported on can be seen in this layout. Okay, so let's see first the schematic of the design that we have synthesized. This is the schematic of the device. We have some input buffers and output buffers, and an LUT is used to design the logic. We can also see the device. So this is how a particular RTX 7 FPGA looks like, and it has all these components. So I'll just, so we have I/O banks, separate I/O banks, and we have some 6 I/O banks in this particular FPGA, and all of these are colored. You can see the clock regions. These are the clock regions. These are the different sites that are there, and these are the ports and nets. So let us see how our input and output is mapped here. If you see here, this portion, when I click, there are some white dots that have been shown. So those are the 3 input ports that we have been, that has been used inside the board. And if you see here, it's very, not that clear actually. So these are the white dots that you see is a output port that we have used. And if I click this, you can see the routing resources. So I'll just show you the basic. This is a basic FPGA fabric that we have. This is one slice. We have 4 6 input LUTs and 6 flip-flops, some muxes, XOR gates. So this is how a particular FPGA that you must have learned, an organization of an FPGA is, and these are the routing resources. Yes, actually I'll show just now. Actually our design is very small, so I'm not able to locate it. In the next tutorial I'll just look. We'll see a bigger design in the next tutorial. So,
Maybe its color will be something different.
Yes, yes. Okay, so that's all for today's tutorial. So we have successfully ported a FPGA design onto the board.